I'll tell you why. I need one week for summer hustle drivers.
We're back in open session. Next item is item 4A, report gifts accepted on behalf of the board for policy CDC local, Mr. Madrigal.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chair. We have for Carol Bell Elementary from Walmart for student incentives for $500. Again, student support services from GFL and Associates Supplies for $200. We also have to our special education department from Richard Golick for What's Next Symposium for $100. Again, to our special education department from Linda Solis for What's Next Symposium for $50. We also have a special education from Walmart for What's Next Symposium that's coming up for $1,500. Some other donations, fine arts from HEB for supplies for $1,000. We have some campus funds donations also, Harndale High School from Robert Stotzenberger for $1,500. Harndale High School for the P16 Plus for student incentives for attendance for $4,000. Stonewall Flanders Elementary from Ford, Powell, and Carson Architects for $300. And that's for student field trips. We have Royal Elementary from the P16 Plus for student incentives for, again, attendance, $2,000. Early College High School, P16 Plus, again, for student incentives for attendance, $2,000. We have, again, for the student group donations, Harndale High School, Nancy Tom, supplies for $100. Harndale High School for the band boosters for band supplies for $2,175. Some other non-monetary donations we have for student support services from Holy Spirit Catholic Church for various gifts for needy families for $950. Then we have for student support services from Mr. Albert Ureste for students for supply for event for $150. And then we have for special education Bud Jones gift cards for $20. Again, for a grand total of $16,545.
Thank you, Mr. Madrigal. 4B, Finance Committee Report, Mr. Quesada.
Yes, sir, and I'll hand that off to Mr. Richard Hernandez, please.
Thank you, Mr. Quesada. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the Finance Committee meeting was held on January 11, 2016. The meeting was called to order at 6:28 by Mr. Quesada. Members present was Ms. Cáceres and Mr. Moreno. Staff members present was the superintendent and myself. The first item that we covered was the investment quarterly report ending December 31st, 2015. The amount invested for the general fund was $59 million. In for debt service was $16 million, and capital projects $44 million, for a grand total of approximately $120 million. All of the investments are in pool accounts, agency securities, money market, commercial paper, municipal bonds, and brokered CDs. They are all of an investment grade level, so they are safe securities in accordance with our CDA legal policy. Interest rate earnings range from 0.24 to 2.10. The investment reports are in your board package on page 7 through page 10. The next report covered was the budget quarterly report for the period ending December 31st, 2015. The amount of the most significant items to note during that report was the collection of taxes. Approximately 48% was collected regarding the general fund. Also reported was the amount of state funding that we get per month. As far as the cash needs that are necessary, based on the state's computations for payments to school districts. Another revenue area was the receipt of the SHARS and MAC reimbursement program that reimburses us for the special ed costs that the district incurs. The level of expenditures is approximately 44%, which is about the level that we should be at based on the 10-month instructional operational period. Other areas of the report that were covered were basically the functional expenses, starting with the instructional areas to student support areas. Another report that was covered was the different types of programs that the district administers, which is the basic education service programs, special ed, and bilingual. The last two reports covered in the quarterly report was the child nutrition and debt service fund, which reflected again in debt service the amount of taxes collected and the IFA and EDA monies received. Also noted was a forthcoming $4.5 million in bond payments that is coming due in February. The quarterly reports are on in your board book, beginning on page 11 through page 14. Adjournment of the meeting was at 7:11 p.m.
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez.
Yes, sir.
Moving on to item 4C, Curriculum Committee Report. That's me, but I'm going to defer this to, I think, Ms. Casey, is you going to come up? Or Mr. Madrigal? Oh, Ms. Cormins is going to come. Ms. Cormins.
The Curriculum Committee minutes for December 17, 2015. The meeting was called to order at 6:20 p.m. by Mr. Ricardo Moreno, board member, called the meeting to order as Mr. Abundis was, chairperson was not present. I'm just reading it. Board members present were Ms. Cáceres and Mr. Moreno. The staff present was Mr. Madrigal, Dr. Harrell, Ms. Taylor, Mr. Anthony Kazravi, and Mr. Littlefield, our district information and reporting coordinator. Citizens to be heard, there were none, and the individual items reviewed and discussed were as follows. The CBAs, number 1 through 3, are the data review, which is the curriculum-based assessments. Mr. Littlefield shared the purpose of conducting CBAs assessments were to record, examine, and share data with teachers, students, and parents depicting TEKS mastery by students, class, grade level, school, and content area. Each CBA is different depending on what TEKS are being taught each 6 weeks. The number of items vary from 10 on the first CBA to 10 to 15 on the second and third CBAs. The fourth CBA will have approximately about 15 items. Campus reviews the data to form tutoring and intervention enrichment groups, decide what lessons need to be retaught, etc. Second item, community and student engagement evaluation. Dr. Harl shared the HISD development and revised evaluation. The evaluation will be conducted at each school with staff and CPERC input, then reported back to her for PEAM submission in June. She reminded the committee that the locally developed evaluation is an opportunity to showcase excellence in 9 areas, which also include recognizing areas needing growth. Last year, HISD received a recognized distinction. The 9 areas are 1, fine arts, 2, wellness and physical education, 3, community and parent involvement, 4, 21st century workforce development program, 5, second language acquisition programs, 6, digital learning environment, 7, dropout prevention strategies, 8, educational programs for GT students, 9, compliance with statutory reporting and policy requirements. C, performance-based monitoring analysis system, also known as PBMAS, reports updates. Ms. Taylor shared the results of the district TAES intervention system plan required as part of the PBMAS follow-up. The focus on the address of special education compared to general education students is our discipline and alternative placement data. The plan highlighted additional professional development on sites with support by staff and Region 20 specialists, increased collaboration and planning with the People Personnel Department and campus administration. D, technology survey update. Mr. Casavarari shared an update regarding the board request a technology survey that was prepared in the fall and sent out to campuses the week before Thanksgiving. Campuses were asked to distribute a hard copy home technology survey to every student. Additionally, the survey was in English and in Spanish was put on the district's webpage. As of December 14th, there were 1,169 responses that depicted student home usage by campus, by grade level, by language spoken, by internet access, type of access, homework usage, in other locations, type of preferred educational websites used at school, feelings about technology, email accounts usage at home, student family understanding, and the student acceptable use policy, opinions regarding importance in the workforce, HISD preparation of technology proficiency, lab usage provided in the district, etc. Ms. Casares had expressed a desire of having up to 5,000 responses so a better picture of technology needed and possible use could inform planning. As of January 12, 2016, 1,831 results have been reported, and the results are included in the board packet. The January Curriculum Committee will discuss the updated results and implications for planning. Committee members suggested additional technology usage opportunities be provided to our community and students at College Cafe, and SOSA that IT explore the use of text messages and smart communications. TEA announcements. Dr. Hall shared that the 2014-2015 Texas school report cards were available and on TEA website, listed the TEP website location. And then the meeting was adjourned and was conducted by Mr. Moreno at 7:22.
Thank you, Ms. Cormans. Moving on to item 4D, Policy Committee report. Mr. Moreno.
Board Policy Committee met Monday, January 11, 2016. The meeting was called to order by myself at 4:35 p.m. In attendance were Mr. Juan Mancha, board member, Mr. Ray Madrigal, superintendent, and Ms. Diane Tudyk, executive director of human resources. Update 103 was the first of the two post-legislative sessions, and it encompasses changes in the law from the 84th legislative session that had an immediate effect on the governance and management of school districts. Local policies policy topics address training for peace officers, employees, conflicts of interest and standards of conduct, harassment and discrimination, e-cigarettes, and student attendance. Update 103 also includes recommendations on federal grant regulation and application of policy in relation to the award of credit or a final grade. The purpose of the meeting was to look more closely at the 12 local policies affected. The two that were already addressed in the content of the exhibits which are the administrative in nature, not subject to board approval, and a different way to house statutory materials. This allows the updates and changes in a more efficient manner without bogging down the board. Exhibit updates, as always, will be brought to policy committee. Policy EFFA encourages local school boards and administrators to adopt procedures for the selection of adoption materials that include parent input and public meeting. Ms. Tudyk shared that CNI has this in place already. Policy FFAC referenced the administration of the EpiPen, which is the epinephrine auto injectors. At this time, the district is choosing to maintain its EPI protocol at the recommendations of staff. Active conversations centered around the policies associated with the new open carry law that became effective January 1st, 2016. Mr. Mancha recommended that the principals understand and share this information with their staff and community. Mr. Madrigal shared that Chief Ramirez had or was already scheduled to do so the following Wednesday. And information will be shared with the board via HH and or a presentation, but I think we found it all in our packets. The committee agreed to bring this to the January board meeting for first reading, and the meeting was adjourned at 5:18 p.m.
Thank you, Mr. Moreno. Ms. Cormans, just for the record, what are we adopting this year? What subject matters and what grade levels? Reading? Elementary reading, middle school, or just elementary?
Thank you, sir.
Just elementary reading then this year? Any other subjects? Just make sure that when we coordinate this, as we move forward, the dual language program, let's not leave those guys behind. Okay, thank you. Moving on to item 4E, report board member continuing education credits for 2015, Mr. Madrigal.
Yes, at this time I'll go ahead and have that Ms. West will provide me a copy of the reading and the course. Thank you, Ms. West. Again, Harndo ISD board containing education credit. Again, the total minimum hours per new board member is 16, and for experienced board members is 10 hours. Experienced board members need 10 hours in total, and of course, a non-legislative year, and 12 hours in a legislative year. Again, we're here to share that all of our board members met the state requirements. And again, I'm required to read out the number. Mr. David Munoz had a status of 18 30.50. Ms. Carrillo had 32.50. Ms. Casas had 12.00. Mr. Mancha had 13.00. Mr. Moreno had 32.15. Mr. Quesada had 14.00. Mr. Uresti had 13.00. Again, for a total of continuing education credit to our board for 135.15. And again, all of our board members met the requirements set for by TASB and the state.
Thank you, Mr. Madrigal. Moving on to item 4F, the board will hear report on the district's options regarding the new legislation on HB 2610. And Mr. Moreno kind of touched on it earlier. So this is something that just for the rest of us, because I think only him and who are the other two, Ms. Policy, so the policy committee members, Mr. Mancha, Mr. Gutt. So for the rest of the board members, we wanted to kind of hear what was going on with this HB 2610, which is at open carry.
Yes. This is actually different. This has to do with instructional minutes.
Instructional minutes. That was the other one. The other big one.
Right. So basically, the 84th Texas legislation, they passed this bill, 2610, and what it did is it struck the original language of requiring instructional days. It now moved to minutes. So we went from requiring 100 days of instruction to 75,600 minutes. The idea was it would allow campuses to time if they needed to close for whatever reason, whether it's weather, bad weather, or some kind of incident. It takes effect this year, but this year is also a transition year. So we have to report days for this year in PEAMS. However, we're in minutes, so that's the transition piece. What that means is that for our district, even though we're reporting days, we need to keep on hand documentation that indicates we did satisfy the 75,600 minutes. Early release days, the state has set a limit of 210 minutes. So if we're here less than that or more than that, we will get 210 minutes for each of our early release days. This was approved in June, an FAQ was released by TEA in September, and then in November, TEA sent out a little more clarification for their accounting handbook for attendance. That typically is out in August. So there was kind of this delay of information. What we did is we looked at this recently, and we looked at elementary, middle, and high, and the graph shows the times we start and the times we end, and as you can see, we have scattered times. Then we have the minutes per day that each school is in class, and then for each 6 weeks. So if you can see elementary, middle, and high, we're well above the days of the requirement of 75,600. In fact, the difference for elementary equals over 8 days. For middle and high, we're at 15 and 13. But as we continued, we had to look at our special schools because we just don't have our comprehensive traditional schools. So I'm going to skip down to the head of high school. We're over 1 day approximately, and STEM, we're over 20 days. When we looked at DAEP and boot camp, they do have a different schedule, and they're actually both short. They're short 14 days, and they're short 1 day. However, those students are going to be kind of covered under the time they're at their regular campus to the time they go in. It's a temporary placement. And their minutes will basically, their excess minutes from their home campus will kind of spill over. The area and the one school that we didn't meet the requirement is the head and middle. So if you look, we are short at this point 14 days. So if we continue the school year at the current time, we will be short 14 days or 5,500 minutes. What we went from there is we said this is something we got to kind of present, look at what are our options. So basically, if we increase the day by 75 minutes, and that time could be 5 or 10 minutes less depending on our start date, there's 25 students currently enrolled. So we're talking about 25 eighth graders. We had to look at the campus master schedule, and we did find options that we could work through. We looked at individual students as well, not only here at the HEDA, but individual students that are spending time at HAC to make sure their minutes were accounted for. And then, of course, we wanted to work it within teacher hours. It's January, second semester, and we wanted to look at teacher hours. We have options for communicating with parents. We have a letter. There's a form letter. We can also use phone master, phone calls, meetings. With the 25 kids, I think we can make that a very personal endeavor. Some of the things that will change that will impact our families is in the morning, how the kids are picked up. Some are picked directly from the home, and then they're transported to their middle school, and then from the middle school, they're transported to the HEDA. So some of them have like a transfer bus. Other students walk from their home to the middle school and then they're transferred. That's going to change because if we do change the time, times will change. After school, they are released in time to get to the middle school where there are people on campus to supervise them. And then from there, they can either walk home, catch a transfer bus to their home. After school time will change because middle school has a different schedule. They will be they will be bused to the high school, and then they will be sent from there. They'll either walk home or they will take a bus home. And we've kind of tracked transportation. Mr. Ramirez and Mr. Soto did a great job. They have it all, and we have it set up where we actually know some of the kids that are walking are actually closer to home at this point if we do this. Some of our options. And this is something that we really had to consider what are the best options. So for one, we can change the students' hours effective Monday. We have a plan, I think it's a solid plan. I think that we can really impact students positively, kind of reduce or limit the negative impacts on families and teachers. We can consider the actions of and the decisions of neighboring districts. Mr. Madrigal can speak more to that, but his fellow superintendents have opted to not make changes. And their hours are vastly different, and they're not talking about 25 kids, they're talking about thousands of kids. We can wait for clarification regarding House Bill 2610 and continue our current schedule. And there is a suggestion that the state may hold harmless districts for 2015-2016. We often see that term in accountability for assessment, and this is something that people are suggesting may happen. Moving forward, lesson learned, we will look at our instructional days, the length. We're looking at aligning all the elementary, middle, and high schools for next year. Our DPERC is currently reviewing and updating calendars, and every calendar will designate minutes. So this is something we will definitely prevent from happening next year. It's just something that we're dealing with at this point.
Mr. Chair.
Yeah, Mr. Madrigal.
At this time, while Ms. Casey's on this particular PowerPoint presentation, I do want to share with you that, last Wednesday we had the Bexar County Region 20 and superintendent's meeting. And of course, one of the biggest discussions at our meeting was, again, House Bill 2610 and the state converting and changing. And again, in our conversation as superintendents, and again, working with Ronnie Beard, the CEO of Region 20, and Jeff Goldhorn, which had a meeting with TA and our new commissioner the day before. Again, it's been very difficult for every school district to get clarification. And again, all school districts adopt a calendar prior to August. And again, in our conversation, as we asked how many school districts change their calendar in August for this year to meet the requirements, and of course, none. We in Harlandale have the Haylett Middle School that will need to make the adjustment. But again, like mentioned earlier, there's many, many school districts. And of course, I had this conversation with our board president last Wednesday that do not meet the current state requirements of the new legislation to come out. But again, we're still waiting for more clarification from TEA. Again, with that said, the conversation Mr. Bunis and I had were that we wanted to bring it to the rest of the board to decide. Harlandale has a plan to implement to make that adjustment here beginning on January 25th, or do you would like to wait till the upcoming school year and again go with TEA's possible of leaving us harmless for this year of the new implementation?
The problem is, and Mr. Oresto will probably find out this next week, the legislature runs from January 1st to December 31st. The school years, of course, run from August to June. So when they made this into law, it took effect January 1st, which is in the middle of the school year. Just having dialogue with Mr. Madrigal, most districts are going to hold harmless. They're not going to start this until the next school year. And I think we feel comfortable with that decision, and that's okay with you guys because the larger districts are doing it. So we don't see that TEA coming in and shooting those guys down or making a big deal out of it if those districts are not doing it. And we just have to correct it for next year for sure. And I think they have a plan. But I think in the middle of the year, kind of last minute telling the parents this is what's going to happen, I think our community might not like that change, that abrupt change. So we would like to wait till next school year to start this plan. Mr. Mancha.
Mr. Chair, I agree with you. My concern was the pickup time for the parents. Some of the kids will walk, but then you got some parents that are already used to picking up their kids at a certain time. one thing. Second, the bus drivers, they're gonna be changing their time, staff, custodial. We don't have you looked at a plan on how we're gonna work on that?
Mr. Chair, to answer Mr. Manchez, yes, all that has been addressed. We have a plan already. The conversation Mr. Abunis had and wanted to share with the rest of our colleagues, is it something that we want to implement beginning the 25th, that Monday, and add to make the changes? We're ready to go and ready to roll out the plan. Or do we wish to wait and make sure we implement the plan for the next upcoming school year?
I guess my concern is more the staff itself, because they're going to have to stay a little longer.
The staff, like Ms. Casey said earlier in her PowerPoint presentation, it does not change the staff hours.
No?
No. Well, the only thing we're adding is the teacher-student contact at the head of middle school did not meet the new state requirements that came out effective January. Now, it's only that group of kids and only that campus. Everybody, every other campus meets the requirement.
And that's the staff that I'm talking about, sir.
Their current hours, that their employment hours right now, does not affect
at all.
All they're going to do, what will affect, is they're going to spend 30 more minutes with kids earlier than we're used to right now, and later than they're used to, and that's already there in place. That Mr. Salmon has a plan to do that and has addressed the staff. But like I mentioned earlier, Mr. Abunis and I in our conversation wanted to bring it so it'd be dialogue that our entire board could have. And if the wish is for us to implement it beginning Monday, January 25th, we're ready to go. Or if we want to wait till the next school year, that is also an option that this board has at this current time.
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Cáceres, and for record, Ms. Cáceres.
Okay. So we're going over item F, is that correct? The new legislation on
yes.
HB 2610. When did this go through? The legislation?
It just occurred back in June.
Back in June?
Yes, but it didn't take effect until January 1st. See, when the legislature votes, whatever they vote on, they'll start to the next year, which is January 1st. They don't follow the school year when they make changes to school districts.
So we're trying to add 30 minutes in the day and 30 minutes in the afternoon to Frank Tejeda Middle School?
Only to 25 students that we have in the district that do not meet the current House Bill 2610. And again, many, many school districts in the area do not meet the current minutes, and because either elementary is not having, it doesn't have the 75,600 minutes or whatever. But what happened when the law, when everything was, what came out was in August, everybody already adopts their calendars way before that. And a lot of school districts are waiting until next school year. What we wanted to do is bring it to our board attention that elementary, middle school, and high school, and all our schools, Stanley College, High School, everybody meets the state requirements that began to be, it came into law on January the 1st, except for 25 students at Frank Tejeda Middle School. It doesn't increase a school day for teachers or extended time. It's just they're going to spend 30 more minutes with kids a day, and the plan that we have is 30 more minutes in the morning and 30 minutes more in the afternoon, because those kids spend least do not meet the requirement of the new law.
So basically, Ms. Cáceres, in the past it was the students have to be in school 180 days, and right now the Tejeda students are 180 days, but the law changed. It's not 180 days now, it's 75,600 minutes. And right now, the Tejeda students are not, even though they go 180 days, they're not there 75,600 minutes for the year. They're there 70,065 minutes per year. So we have to increase their days to be able to reach that 75,600. But with that affects the teachers, it affects the busing and all that. So our discussion is, we don't necessarily have to start this year, even though the legislature passed. Other school districts like Northside, they're going to wait till next school year to start this 75,600. So we're having a discussion, do we want to wait till the next school year like most districts are doing, or do we want to start implementing this next week?
So for those districts that wait until next school year, wouldn't they be out of compliance somehow? So
that's what we talked about earlier. What do you want to discuss that real quick, Ms. Casey?
There there are some options. We have a plan prepared if we are going to start, say, Monday. And that day we can move. However, the more we delay the date, the longer day the students will have. We could consider actions and decisions from neighboring districts. So Mr. Madrigal has had meetings, and so has Dr. Harrell, regarding what other districts are doing in response to this. We can wait for clarification regarding this from TEA, and we can keep our current schedule. And that one of the suggestions is that the state may hold harmless districts from 2015-16. That happens quite a bit with testing, and they'll implement something new, and then they hold harmless. That's not definite, it's a suggestion.
And Ms. Casas, we had a superintendent meeting with Region 20 and all the area Bexar County superintendents in the region. And of course, Ronnie Beard, the CEO of Region 20, and Jeff Bohorn, that had just been in Austin the day before with our new commissioner, as again, asked those questions, and the number of superintendents of school districts have been asking for clarification, but it's been very difficult to get a clear answer from TEA with all the new adjustments and changes they're making with the new commissioner. Many superintendents here in Bexar County that did not meet, and for example, one particular that is Northside Elementary does not meet the minutes, and it involves 70,000 kids. But of course, their interpretation from TEA is that they're going to be held harmless because, again, one of the frustration is that we're getting requirements to come out in August when we've already started school. And of course, it came up in conversation again because we can't get any clear answers from. So I had that conversation with Mr. Bunis last Wednesday. Okay. Arnda ISD has a plan ready to implement if we wish to. But again, if we want to take the same action as other school districts that feel like they're going to be held harmless because of the timing and no clear clarification from TEA, is an option that we have.
I just wanted to make sure that we weren't going to be held.
I think we'll be okay. It's only for one school. It's to head the middle school. All of our other schools are okay. Meet the requirements. So let me get some dialogue from maybe Mr. Oreste or Mr. Oreste.
I'm good with going that route and asking for the waiver to be held harmless.
Okay. Mr. Moreno?
I feel similarly in that being that it's one school, I think it's in the best interest for us to just utilize, I guess, the waiver that you're alluding to.
Mr. Quesada?
Yeah, no objection to that. I mean, obviously, there's going to be some more clarification that's going to come down from the legislator. But I think it would be a little preemptive for us to make any decisions right now.
Mr. Munson? Back to you, Ms. Cáceres.
So we're suggesting that we go with a waiver.
Wait till the next school year to implement this for that one school.
And wait till the next school year for Frank Tejeda Middle School, correct, for those 25 students?
Mr. Chair, if I may add, I just want to make it clear for the record that, again, we cannot get a clear answer from TEA. There's not about submitting a waiver to say that we want to be held harmless. We don't get any clear answer from TEA right now currently if they're going to hold those schools that are not compliant harmless or not. And we're all asking TEA for a clarification from the new commissioner. And the new commissioner told, again, the CEO from Region 20 and Jeff Bohorn that they are working on clarifying. But again, they're understaffed. They don't have the time and the thing to hold everybody to the new law. And being that they still haven't converted from days to minutes, and we're still recording under our PIMS, like every school district, is days. So we don't, and all the superintendents in Bexar County, we're looking for clarification. We don't know if they're gonna hold us harmless. For us, if they do penalize us, we're talking about 25 kids. Some school districts, you're talking about 70,000 kids. But I wanted in Harlandale to make sure that I brought it to the board president's attention and the board. We have a plan ready to go where if we start Monday the 25th, we have a plan that we do meet the requirements of House Bill 2610 for this remaining school year between now and June. And then next school year, of course, we'll implement it. Adjustment we're gonna have to make next year is to Frank Tejeda Middle School because we already meet the requirements for all our other kids. It's just that one school. But I just wanna make sure it's clear that it's not a waiver and then that way we're held harmless. For some reason, they may decide to come back, but the conversation at Region 20 was they're gonna have to hold us off.
I think for the most part, Ms. Cáceres, I mean, in fairness to school districts, the law when school started was the 180 days. And I think that's why a lot of districts are, you know, saying, wait a minute, and even the neighbor, or the district I work for, all the elementaries do not meet the 75,600. And I think we're moving forward into it into next school year to start this. So I think for me, just for the parents, I know we're ready, but I know there was an issue about 3 weeks ago when we made some changes to emails, and the parents were like, wait, I didn't give us a warning. We weren't prepared for this. So I think this is kind of similar to that, even though we're ready. I don't know if the parents are ready for this type of change. You need to drop out your son earlier or daughter earlier, pick them up later, et cetera. So more for that, I think that's why I think the majority of us are okay with taking the chance that we'll be granted the hold harmless.
Okay.
No further discussion, let's move on to item five. I think I'm looking at the wrong, hold on. Oh, G, I'm sorry, there it is. The first reading, proposed TASB policy update 103 will be presented and recommended to the board for discussion only. Mr. Madriga, who will be handling this?
Yes, at this time I'm gonna go ahead and have Ms. Tudyk kind of again go over the first reading for the proposed TASB policy update 103. Ms. Tudyk?
Yes, sir, thank you. As per recommendation of the board to always bring the policy for a reading and then give the public and community time to digest and come back. So you'll see this again in February. But most of the items, as Mr. Moreno reported in our policy report, had to do with things and changes, for example, the EpiPen, how we do school adoption material. But the biggest conversation was around the open carry law that from House Bill 910 that became effective on January 1st, 2016, and how that impacts public schools and what it looks like. And you'll see that in some of the policies in the CKE and the GKAs, as well as DH.
Mr. Chair, again, all of these updates were provided to each and every one of our board members. So, again, if anybody would like to have any discussion, can now or at a future date with Ms. Tudyk or staff before we bring forward the second reading.
If no further discussion, move on to consent. We have items A through H.
Mr. Chair. I move for approval of item 5A through 5H.
Before I get a second, does anyone want to pull any of them? Will someone second then, please?
I'll second it.
Okay, Mr. Quesada, we have a motion to approve item consent items A through H, a motion and a second. All those in favor? Ayes have it. Motion carries. Moving on to item 6, convening closed session as authorized by the Texas Government Code. Chapter 551, sections 551.071 through 551.084. The items will be the board will discuss the recommended regular personnel report, TGC 551.074, and the board will discuss the midterm review of the superintendent's evaluation. Do I have a motion to go into closed session? A motion?
Second.
A second. All those in favor? The ayes have it. The time is 7:50. We are now in closed session.